Hello. This week we will discuss algorithm analysis in our data structures course. This is a fundamental step before attacking data structures because we will be developing algorithms based on data structures, and we need to measure their time complexities as efficient as objectively as possible. Okay, so we need a formal objective mechanism, and we will learn it today. We will also see some recursion today. We will also analyze their time complexities. An algorithm is a set of instructions to be followed to solve a problem, basically. It is a very common word in computer science, algorithm. There can be multiple solutions to a given problem. And these solutions can also be implemented in different platforms. So we need to be able to compare these solutions independent of the platforms, independent of the programmer, etc. Again, that is the topic of today. An algorithm must be correct regardless of what the input is, regardless of the degenerate cases. It must work correctly. And once we have a correct algorithm, we need to determine how fast it is. Okay, because speed is also a very important thing in our lives. Our lifetime is limited. We don't have much time. So an algorithm can be analyzed from two aspects, time and space aspects. Actually, I have done this in our motivational example. What was that? In the first week, which is recorded, you can go back there. I have shown you how to improve the time complexity of a subarray sum task using a data structure. And I have also shown you how to improve the space complexity of an algorithm. It was about N matrix using another data structure. But in this class, actually, we will focus more on the time issue. Okay, so space is not going to be discussed in detail, but it is also important. Timing. Okay. So how can I compare the timing of different solutions to a given problem? A naive approach is to implement them in a programming language and compare their runtime by looking at our clocks. But this is problematic because of these three reasons. How are the algorithms implemented? It is sensitive to the quality of the programmer, first of all, right? Also, it is sensitive to the computer in use. I can run a nice algorithm on a 2010 computer, and we are in 2020, so it matters. Also, the program, if I run them one by one, it is impossible to test all the permutations of inputs because you are likely to deal with inputs like 10,000s of numbers to be sorted. It is a very common scenario. Even drop to 10,000s of numbers, for instance, permutations, there will be 1,000 permutations of data, which is really a big number. I can't really test them all. So I need a different mechanism to analyze algorithms. And that mechanism depends on counting the significant operations and then expressing the efficiency of algorithms using growth functions, how that number of significant operations grow. Okay, so let's see this in action. Here is my program, which is not even a program, but anyway, count, increase count, and then increase sum. Here, the cost of this statement is constant. So what do I mean by this? The size of the problem here is n, In general, it is n. So what is it? When you are sorting numbers, you are dealing with n numbers. When you are searching a friend in Facebook, n is the number of people registered to Facebook, etc. So in this code segment, there is nothing that depend on n, because even if n is 10,000, I just increase this variable by one. So constant cost, again constant cost. So the cost of this block is constant, sum of two constants. If I have an if else block, then I need to consider the worst case, by the way, because it may happen. So in this scenario, C1 is the cost of this comparison, which certainly gets executed. And again, here nothing is dependent on the problem size. Then I either execute this statement or this statement, so I will take the max of these two. But since they are constants, it is not a big deal here, but in general, we need to take the max of the code blocks in our if-else stuff. Here, finally, something that depends on the problem size n. Here, n is in use explicitly. So here I have also seen an n, but it is not counting until n. Okay, this is just an integer variable. It is just a test of two integers. Here, however, I do something until n. So it gets executed n plus 1 times, n true times, and 1 false time, false case, and that case makes me quit the while loop, so n plus 1. And within the block, I have n steps, because all the n true steps get executed. And I also have some initializations that get executed only once. So with that in mind, we have this cost of C1 plus C2 plus this many times this, the cost of this comparison. Okay, in this case, it is constant. It is just comparing two variables. But again, it is doing it n plus 1 times due to the nature of while loop. And I have C4, C5, they also get executed n times. So, moral of the story, this code block has a time requirement that is proportional to n. Okay, it depends on n. And it depends on n linearly. So there is no n square, for instance. And yeah, so n square comes here now. Why it comes here? Because this block gets executed n plus 1 times, this gets executed n times, and now be careful, I have n plus 1 times execution of this line, but this is within this loop, so it will also called n times due to the outer loop, hence I have n times n plus 1. Similarly inside, guys, n is due to this inner while loop, and the second n is due to the outer while loop. So if you add these numbers, I have something that is proportional to n square, because you can see that I have n squares involved here. So some general rules, not so effective. So yeah, they are general, they are not certain. Like loops, nested loops, you just apply product rule. So again, this is not so important. So now I am coming to this growth rate business. Recall from the previous slide, one algorithm took a time proportional to n, and the other has taken a time proportional to n square. So first of all, I drop these constants, because when analyzing algorithms, I assume that the problem size is large. Because for small sizes, the program, initially there are some overhead costs, like operating system has some overhead initialization costs, and so nothing gets settled exactly. So the behavior of the problem becomes apparent after a certain amount of time. That's why we consider big n's. And when n is like 1000, which is not even big, but in this example, when you are dealing with thousands, number 7, number 5, they really don't matter. Hence, we just say that a is times proportional to n square, not 5n square, and b is times proportional to n. So by time, I mean number of instructions to execute is proportional to n square, or number of steps to be taken is proportional to n square when you want to sort n numbers, for instance, if this is your problem. So in this case, for instance, that threshold happens here. So this is something that is misleading, because in this part where the overhead stuff happens, the operating system stuff, etc., when n is small, for small size inputs, this linear dependence seems to be higher than the quadratic dependence, which is not correct as far as mathematics go, right? Therefore, after a certain amount of time, like in this case, it's 25, because when it is 25, I have 125 here, so 125 seconds, and it is also the same when you take 25 squared times 5, because 1n is going with the denominator, another 25. After this time, I ensure you that this plot will be over the linear plot, okay? So what this graph tells me is, this is my algorithm A, this is the size of its input, and this is the number of steps or number of seconds, they are the same thing, right, to be taken to finish the execution. So like when you have 100, when you deal with a problem of size 100, this A will take much more time, because it grows faster. And this B is more efficient, it will finish early. So in this scenario, this is a better algorithm. It grows slower than B, sorry, than A. Let's put some names to this, to these growth rates. So if it doesn't depend on the problem size n at all, then we have a constant growth rate. So no matter what your problem size is, the runtime is constant, it doesn't get higher, which is a very nice scenario actually, but it is a rare scenario also, because you need to do something with your program and with your problem which has some size. This is a linear growth rate, so when you have 20 items in your problem set and it takes 8 seconds, then when you increase it to 40 items, it will take 16 seconds, because you double the size, then the, since growth rate is linear, the number of steps will also double automatically. But if it is quadratic, then it will be multiplied by 4, right, because 2 squared is 1. And this is an exponential growth, it grows very fastly. Yes, so luckily I have some plots here. So here, this is the input size n, this is the number of steps of number or number of seconds, whatever. So when it is linear, the red line, it is linear as the name says. So when you have 9 items, you need 9 minutes or 9 seconds, whatever. But if it is quadratic, like the purple plot, it's the number of seconds is much higher. So I need to zoom out a little bit. Then you can see that this purple thing is way above the red line. So in particular for the 9 example, I will hit 81. So somewhere here it is out of bounds of this slide, but 81 will be the corresponding point in the purple. So this tells me that quadratic functions grow faster than linear functions. And therefore, They should be avoided if possible. And there are even worse news, like this exponential function, it grows incredibly fast. So when you are dealing with even like one digit size input, like nine size input, with the linear algorithm you have nine steps, it is linear. But with that algorithm you have about 1,000 steps, right? 2 to the 9 is 512. Okay, so you get the idea, right? The yellow plot is way above than the red linear plots. Okay, now these are the growth rates, visual explanations. Now let's get serious, let's get more formal and define something called Big O notation. Okay, so it is, what is that? If algorithm A requires time proportional to G, so number of steps to be taken by algorithm A is Fn. Okay, so n is the size of your problem. It may take maybe n square minus 5 steps. Okay, this is your Fn. So this Fn is order of Gn, or big O Gn. If there exist two constants called x, called k and n0, such that Fn is smaller than a factor of g after some time. So let me write it completely. Fn is smaller, so Fn is bounded from above by OGn. In other words, you can replace this big O with this mathematical symbol. Okay, it helps you understand stuff. So Fn is less than Gn, but a factor of Gn, so k times Gn. For all n values after a particular value n0. Okay, so again, this is about that operating system overhead business. This applies after some n, but once it applies, it will always apply. Okay, yes, so then you can say that Fn is O Gn, big O Gn, if I have this inequality in my hand using these two numbers that I will find. There isn't only one solution. There are many pairs that satisfy this. So we will see examples. Okay, so if algorithm A requires time proportional to n square, so if fn number of steps is proportional to n square, then we say that fn is o n square. So in this scenario, gn is n square. Okay, and you can read the last line with the same logic. Okay, we have the formal definition here anyway. So fn is o gn if fn is less than or equal to gn, but some multiple of some positive factor of gn after some time. Okay, so let's see an example. So here is my number of steps. It is n square minus 3n plus 10. So this is my fn. Let me write this here from scratch. This is my fn, and I will show you that this is actually bounded from above by this function gn. It is a more compact way of writing this. So I won't deal with these small terms. So let's prove it, how it comes. So by this definition, I want to show this fn is less than or equal to k times gn. Okay, so this should be less than or equal to And so I want my gn to be n square. So on the right hand side here, I need to write something big, but it should depend on n square only. So let's start with this n square. So this guy cancels this term. Okay, so n square is less than or equal to n square. Now for this, I will write just write 3n squared. I am overshooting, I know, but no problem. So because this will cancel this, because 3n squared will always be bigger than 3n, and not to mention we even have a minus here. And let's also get rid of this guy, 10. I will just say 10n squared. So I just attack each term independently, which is my approach. There are many others. Actually, in the solution above, it is a different solution. So what just happened is, this left-hand side is less than or equal to 14n squared. So basically, I computed my k value, which is 14. And when does this apply? This applies for all n after what positive value? Like, I guess 1 will immediately work. 0, whatever, 0.5. So let's just put 1, because for 1 it is 10 versus 10. It is 3 versus minus 3, and this is 1 versus 1. So in this scenario, n0 happens to be 1, and k happens to be 14. So this is one solution. Another solution is above, where they find k as 3 and n 0 is 2. Okay, perfectly okay. So, what I have proved here is this function, this is my fn, okay, and in my solution I ended up with 14n square, but in the solution here I just used only n square. So let me also do this version as well to be consistent with this slide. So let's rewrite everything here. So n square minus 3n plus 10, right? Yeah, plus 10. So this is 1n square. It kills this thing. Plus another n square. Okay. This will be bigger than this term. So let's do different signs, because n squared is bigger than or equal to minus 3n for all n. Plus another n squared, just to be compatible here, n squared. So be careful here now. This thing cancels out this 10, but not for when n is equal to 1, because when n is equal to 1, 1 isn't bigger than 10. When n is equal to 3, 9 isn't bigger than 10. So in this scenario, you need to select n bigger than 4, maybe, or 3 point something, but let's call it 4. So in this scenario, to make that this triangled thing satisfied, so I will use 3n squared because of the sum above, and this will hold for all n after 4. Okay, again I am a little bit overshooting, but this is just going to guarantee that this part is also true. Okay, so in this case the pair I found is 3 and 4. Okay, and the visual explanation is after some point, like 1.8, or in my case it is 4. So after this point, like this is 4, so it will be this point. So at this point, they will, this function will already be bigger than this function, right? So at this point, 4. So same idea. 3n square would be your, so n square would be your g function here, And you just prove that fn is OGN. Okay. Fn is OGN where gn is n square. Let's see one more example. 2x plus 2 to the x plus 17 is supposed to be big O 2 to the x. So to make that happen, this guy must be less than or equal to some multiple of 2 to the x. So let's put 1 2 to the x. That cancels this first term, okay? Because 2 to the x is less than or equal to 2 to the x at all times. Plus, I need another 2 to the x style thing to deal with the 17. So this will deal with this term. But again, be careful. So basically, I have used 2 times 2 to the x, which makes my k equal to 2. Okay, so this is the k. But this holds for all n. Be careful here. For all x, sorry, in this case there is no n. Bigger than or equal to what? Let's think about it. When x is 1, this triangle inequality fails because 2 isn't bigger than or equal to 17. When x is 4, this is again going to fail because 16 isn't bigger than or equal to 17. So let's use 5. Okay, you can also use 4.4. Something, but let's go into here. When x is 5, I have 32 killing this constant 17, and since this is a constant number, it can't grow at all. So after 32, it will always beat the 17. So in my scenario, n0 or x0 is 5 and k is 2. Okay, so it's a similar problem. 2 to the x plus 17 grows less than this term because again replace big O with this less than or equal to sign. So this looks okay to me. So let's just use only one of 3 to the x. Okay, so 1 times which makes k equal to 1. Because 3 to the x beats 2 to the x. Okay. However, there is a problem of 17 here. When I am dealing with small numbers, 17 is a problem. Like when x is 2, I have 9 versus something bigger than 9 plus another thing, so it fails. So 17 dominates when x is 2. So let's just use big x values, like in the scenario. This holds for all x bigger than or equal to, like, I don't know, 4. Is 3 good? 27 versus 25, it is already good. So, and then, since it is constant, it can't grow, it will not dominate me anymore. So, in this scenario, k is 1 and 0 or x0 is 3. Let's go visual here. Fn is big O gn, meaning that fn is less than or equal to some factor of gn, some positive multiple of gn. So, and this happens after some n0. Again, before that, I don't really care about the behavior. So this is the visual explanation. Then comes this omega notation, okay, this notation, big O, fn is omega gn, then it is the opposite way around. So just like you replace big O with less than or equal to sign, you will replace omega with greater than or equal to sign. So it means that fn is bigger than gn, fn is above gn after some time n0. And again, I will use some factor of gn, some positive multiple of gn. And there is also this theta notation. It is like the sandwich. I will use the same function gn, but with different positive constants like c1 and c2, and I will sandwich fn in between. So this, you can read this like equal, okay? Fn is equal to, because it is both bigger than some factor of gn, it is also less than or equal to some factor of gn, hence we can read this as equal. So theta is equal, big O is less than or equal, omega is greater than or equal. We also have small letter versions of big O and omega, where we just use equalities. Okay, so if fn is less than or equal to k times gn, then I have big O gn going on. But if fn is strictly less than k times gn, then I have big O, smaller. Okay, similarly for omega, what is omega? For omega, we have small letter omega. So let's test this theta thing. Okay, so they claim that this fn, this number of steps, is equal to gn equal to n square. Okay, so I need to go two ways. So this guy must be less than or equal to some multiples of k1 times n square. So I will first solve this, prove this for some, for all n bigger than or equal to n0. So I will first find this, and then I will also find that version. This statement is bigger than or equal to gn with a different constant, obviously. I can't do it with the same constant because of mathematical rules. And so here I will require another initialization. So n0, let's say this n0 1, this is n0 2. Okay, I need two different things. So let's do this. Actually, I have a solution here. It is messy, so let's do it from scratch. So let's first solve this. By the way, if you solve this part the first time, it will show that it will show the big O stuff. So it will show that fn is big O n square. So how does this go? 7n square plus 1 is less than or equal to, I will use another 7n square to kill the first term. Okay, so this handles this, plus I will use 1n square to deal with this term. Okay, and but be careful, I can't deal with this term 1 versus n square when n is 0.5, because 1 is not less than 0.5 square, which is 0.25. So this goes well for all n bigger than or equal to 1. In this scenario, this guy will be 1. And my k1 is 8. Okay, so 7 plus 1 is 8. So this is handled. Now also, from the basic, I have handled which plot fn is big O. So I did this part. So c2 here corresponds to k1 in my notation here. Now I have an upper bound. Now let's put a lower bound here by proving that 7n square plus 1 is bigger than or equal to n square. So obviously, so 1n square is enough, because 7n square kills n square for all n. And also plus 1 kills plus 0. So this basically works for all n. No questions asked. All n. So in this scenario, what just happened is I am using k2 equal to 1. So this will be 1 only. k1. And n0 is 0. But one last thing you need to be careful. So I have this thing is working when n is bigger than 1. So it doesn't work when n is 0.5. When n is 0.5, this thing works. But I need both to work at the same time. So I will have only one n0, actually. So then I can correct this. There is no n1 and n2, okay? So I can't use 0.5. I need to use the max of these two, because like 1.2 will work for this naturally, okay? If I use the max of 1 and 0 as my n0, I am good. But if I use the minimum of them, like 0.5, then this equation will fail. So you will get the max of them, which will make your n0 equal to 1. 0 is 1, k1 is 8, k2 is 1. So, if you have a problem size of 10, and if so, let's see the growth rate of, when, of a linear function, then the value of this function will still be 10. When you have 1 million elements, you have 1 million steps linearly. But if you have a quadratic growth, then for 10 inputs, 10 numbers, you need to do 10 square steps. And it is even worse when you deal with an exponential growth rate. Like when you have 10 numbers, you have 2 to the 10 steps. But let's see higher values. Like in this scenario, when linear, you have 1 million steps. It is acceptable because you have 1 million elements anyway. But if your algorithm is growing exponentially, the steps, number of steps, then you have a number that can't be even be written on a piece of paper. So you will die before this program finishes, to be sadly to be true. And also, if your function is constant, it doesn't get affected by the size of the input. It will always execute in a constant number of steps. Sometimes I have even better complexity is from linear. It is called logarithmic complexity. So logarithmic, it means for 1 million, I only need 19 steps to go from 1 to 1 million. So I go like 1, 2, 4, 8. So if I do it 19 times, I will hit 1 billion, believe me. Yeah, so this is just repeating what I said, it's visual here. Let's put something in numbers here. So if an algorithm takes 1 second to run with a problem size of 8, what is the time when you have a problem size of 16? So you double the problem size. If your growth rate is constant, it will still execute in 1 second, no problem. But if it has a linear growth rate, then since input is doubled, the execution time will double from 1 second to 2 seconds. If it is quadratic, execution time is doubled, but this will be increased by 2 to the 2, which is 4. So 1 times 4 is 4, it will take 4 seconds. Some tips about growth rates. So if you have a growth rate like this, you just really put the term with the highest order inside the parentheses, because it comes naturally with my solutions before, right? So this thing is, sorry, let's not write it again, let's write it again. This thing is less than or equal to n square anyway, right? Because for n square plus 3n, this is also equal to big O n cube, because I can use 1 n cube to kill this thing, another n cube to kill this thing for a good n0 initialization, and another n cube to handle this thing. So it is 3 n cube, and again, that 3 is our k constant term. So see, I can get rid of all the low order terms by my this killing tactic, okay? So long story short, if you have an equation like this, you will just keep the highest order term, again without any constant multiplier in the beginning, because it is just in the definition of Big O, that constant. You can skip it here. Okay, this is what I am saying here actually. We can ignore the multiplicative constant in the higher order term of an algorithm's growth rate function. So like 5n cubed, we don't write 5 here at all. It is just n cubed. For big n's, 5 is just this tiny number. Okay, that is the intuition behind that. And if you have multiple steps, so your algorithm has one function that runs in n cubed time, and another function is called then sequentially that goes linear. So basically, you can write them together because they are sequential operations within the same Big O. But then you can come back to your first rule and ignore the low order terms. So basically, it is still O n cubed. Okay, so with that in mind, let's solve our previous problems more rigorously. In this case, I have a function proportional to n, some constant times n plus b. So the growth rate here is on, okay, because low order terms go away and the constant goes away. I can just compactly write it as big O n. Similarly, this is big O n cubed because all the n many iterations, because I also depends on n. So I have n cubed growth rate here. I have another growth rate. Again, low orders go away, as well as the multiplicative constant. So we have big O n squared. See how it simplifies my life? All because of this killing action. Okay, we have derived this idea before. So let's solve another problem. Can f and g functions exist under these circumstances? So f is theta g, okay, and at the same time it also satisfies the Big O part, but it won't satisfy the omega part. So can this happen? I guess yes. So let's go visual. So I have my little stuff here. I can get this thing here. So let's do this. Because f is f is theta, so I am in this figure, right? F is bounded from above and below by g, so big O and small letter O is okay. But although I claim that it has a lower bound of g, now I say no, it can't happen. So this can't happen, right? It contradicts with the definition of theta. How about this? Yes. So a function, so let's focus on this plot, can be bigger than gn, yes, and it can also be, so this small letter, lowercase letter, says that, so this function, so let me draw it again, this is my g, some factor times gn, okay, and f is somewhere above it, and sometimes it may just be equal to this function, and then it may go above again. Okay, so this, in this scenario, f is equal to small omega g fails, because this is strictly above g, okay, this f. So if I have this behavior, then small letter omega fails. This is no. But in this configuration, not such problem, it can happen. So so this corresponds to this exact plot actually. Okay. How about this? I have all no's, only one is. So again, okay, be careful here. I have this function f, That is less than, so here is my g, it's a constant c, and I have an f function that is always less than this g. Okay, so yeah, this can happen, yes. But it is no, why? No, because be careful, there is a problem here. It claims that it is not big O of g, but it is small of O g. Okay, so currently this is small O of g, okay, but if it is the case, then it also satisfies the big O naturally, okay. So this can't be no then, so I can't have a contradiction like this. How about the other way? Can I have a function with that is between g and n, but without touching them? Because remember, small letters, this allows you the touchings, the equalities. So yes, it can happen. How about this? So this e is the opposite of c. So you can get the idea here as well. Big O is yes, but small O is no. But this is possible. So let me show it like this again. Redraw. So this is C times T. Yeah? Okay. And then I have this F function, which is like this. It will touch here at some point. So this is big O of T. Okay. F is that. But since it is touching it, small o is not. Okay, so it can happen. So it just happened in this configuration. So this is yes. And finally, I have a function, two functions, so weird that everything is no. And it is also possible if we think carefully. So this is my g function. And f is sometimes above it, sometimes below it, sometimes above, sometimes below, so it oscillates. So in that scenario, neither of these equations are valid, all no, but it can happen under this oscillating behavior. So we have a yes here. More examples here. We have matrix multiplication operation. So it requires cubic action because size of one matrix is n. I have square matrices n times n. To set this entry, I will go to the ith row here, which will so go to the ith row and then go through all the columns of it and hit these numbers with the jth column in the second matrix. So this is a regular matrix multiplication code. All the lines, all the upper bounds will be n, so I have n cubed. How about this one? This is log n, be careful. If I have j equal to j plus 1 in the incremental part, then it would be on, okay? Because I go from 1 to 32, one by one. I need 31 steps. However, here I go here in this manner: 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. So basically, I need log n steps: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps, because I double my j at every iteration. Okay, let's go further with the examples. So this fn is big O of n square, because we have solved this actually. It is theta. It can be bounded from above and below by n square. So then I have all these three in action. And I can just restrict them to be not equal to, because they can be equal. So not the small letters. How about this 6 to the n versus n to the 6? Obviously, this grows faster than this thing, right? because this is an exponential thing. The exponent is variable, very dangerous. It grows very bigly, very quickly. So it is bigger than or omega than n 6, and also it is not strictly bigger. So I can also accept the small letter omega. N factorial is, recall, it is the multiplication of n terms, but the terms get smaller and smaller as I go to the right. N minus 2, etc. So this is the left hand side. On the right hand side, I have another n terms, but all of them are n. Okay, so this beats this thing, this beats this thing. So this is bigger than this thing, which makes O here as well as a small O. Yes. Well, this is some calculus knowledge here. You don't have to know this, but some of these terms will convert to ln n. Hence, we have that quality theta, which comes with big O and big omega. So this is more interesting. Ln n cube by logarithmic knowledge, this 3 comes before. Okay, so I have 3 ln n equal to ln, so I have theta behavior, which comes with the big O and big omega stuff automatically. Now let's do some recursion. Okay, here is a problem to be solved. You need to transfer the items from here to here, but the solution is not that important. I want to focus on the recursive part here. With a function, what are the number of steps when you have an input of size n? So you want to sort n disks. So we call it tn, the number of steps needed or the time needed to handle an input of size n. So in this scenario, what you do is you create a smaller version of the same problem. This is called recursion. Okay, so basically, by definition, that smaller version will require this many steps, because I have one victim here, one is lost. But be careful, I have two of them. So I have two times this. And other than this, I have some constant operations like comparison, printing, etc. So I just put SC for those constants. Okay, so this makes the recurrence equation of that function equal to this. So Tn is equal to this. So this gives you an idea about the growth rate, but it is a recurrence equation. There is no, but it is not enough for me. I want this to look like big O of something. Okay, so I want a non-recursive or big O based right hand side here. So let me get it by using something called substitution rule. So what is this Tn? So this is my input. I know that it is equal to 2Tn plus C. So let's reopen this. Plug n minus 1 to this equation. So this 2 is from it. So it becomes 2 times Tn minus 2 plus C. Okay, so this part comes. And from above, I owe you this 2 and this C. So this C is this C. Let's reopen it one more time. Plug n minus 2 here, which gives you 2 times tn minus 3 plus c, so that block. And then I put what I owe you from the line above, which are these guys. So you do this 2 or 3 times, and then you get a pattern. So for the ith step, what is happening? So you need to see this. So this is the smart part here. When you look carefully, when I subtract I from n, okay, I need to hit that t with 2 to the I, okay, because in this scenario, 3 is multiplied, subtracted, so pattern is 3 2s are hitting it, so 2 to the power of 3. Here 2 is subtracted, 2 to the 2 is hitting t, okay, so I have 2 to the I times this. How about the constants? So let's count it again without panicking. So let's stick with this line. For instance, I have 1 C, that is left out of everything. This is this. This C is hit on by only 1, 2, which is this, so 2 to the 1. And this C is hit by 2 2s. This bigger one as well as this inner one. Okay, so that is the end of it. Recall that I have I 2s, but I only hit it with I minus 1 of them. So this is the crucial part. Once you derive this, then you apply this trick. I claim that T0 is 1 for all the problems. So you can use this shortcut whenever you are in trouble. Because what this says is, a problem of size 0 takes constant amount of time, right? So there is no problem at all, actually. So it just runs in one time, one instruction. Okay, so T0 is 1. So to get T0 here, I set I equal to n, which makes T0 here, and which makes 2 to the n here. And this will also rewrite this with n's. So what I have in hand is then 2n plus, I just put 1 for this, plus this sum, times c. So what is that sum? So let's also do that sum. So what is this sum? We have, this is called telescopic series in math. They do it all the time. So, okay, here is a trick to solve it. You say a equal to this sum, 1 plus 2 plus 4, all the way up to 2 to the n minus 1. Okay, I write it from in the reverse order. So what is 2a then? Okay, I multiply everything by 2. So I have 2, 4, 8, and it goes all the way until 2 to the n. So what is 2a minus a? Basically, they cancel, they cancel, they cancel, they cancel. So I end up with 2 to the n minus 1. Okay, so this summation is also handled. Long story short, we have 2 to the n plus 2 to the n minus 1 times some constant. And this is, as we know, so as we learned, this can be written because I have lower order terms that can be deleted. I have 2 times 2 to the n. 2 is deleted, so this is equal to 2 to the n. Okay, so this is how I solve it. Factorial is another function that can be written recursively like this, as you know. Here I want to notice something, and it is like a spoiler alert because I like to ask these questions in the exam as well. With that logic of the previous example, you can write Tn is equal to n times Tn minus 1, because you have a new problem of size n minus 1, but you can't put n here, because you really have only one problem generated with this size. You don't have n problems. N is just an integer that hits this value. So you have 1 times Tn minus 1 plus some constant work like comparison, returning, function calls, etc. I just put a constant here. So this is my equation. Let's also apply the substitution rule here. When I plug n minus 1 here, I end up with 2n minus 2 plus c, and this c is my o from above. What is tn minus 2? It will be tn minus 3 plus c, and I owe you this and this, which are here and here. So here is my pattern. When I drop I from n, I need to add I many c's, okay? And then I need to reach t0 trick. So to make that possible, I is equal to n, which makes t0 plus nc. So this is 1. So what is this? This is equal to on, because big O n tells me to drop the multiplicative constant and the low order terms like this. And here is the call stack, how it looks like as I execute factorial of 2. or tree, sorry, bns tree, since base case isn't applied, I call another function fact2, because I call it with one less than the input. Fact2 calls fact1, this is fact1, fact1 calls fact0, but now be careful, since n0 is the base case, it just returns 1, number 1. So this returns number 1. That one is written to that fact1 call, which returns 1 times 1, it is 1. That returns to the fact2 call, which was waiting the result of fact1, which is 1. So I have 2 in my pocket. And finally, it comes back to the fact3 call, which was waiting for fact2, and that result has announced to be 2. Okay, so I have 6. And this is how the call stack grows and shrinks in the execution of this function. So this is just an application of stacks, by the way. Okay. Another problem is a given string palindrome. So it reads the same from left to right and right to left, like kabak is my string. So in this solution, we look at the first character k and the last character c, so the last n minus 1 index. If they are the same, then I have a potential to have palindrome, so it returns true, and I test the same for the substring that runs from this index to the n minus 2 index. So for ABBA, it is the same, A and A, they match, and then I call it with only B, which has a length of 1, so length of 1, it is always palindrome, so I return true. Okay, this is how I do palindrome test recursively. What is the runtime of this? From a given problem of size n, here size of the problem is size of the characters, I create a new problem of size n minus 2. Be careful, I drop the first and last terms. And I do some constant work like returning, equality test, etc. So let's open this n minus 2, plug it here. I end up with tn minus 4 plus c, and this plus c is my depth from above. Let's do it one more step. Tn minus 4 is tn minus 6 plus c, and I have two c's from above. Now let's see the pattern. When I drop I from n, I need to put I over 2 c's here because of this 2 behavior. So again, I need to obtain t0, it is in the heart of everything. To get that done, I is equal to n, which makes n over 2 times c. And by big O notation, I eliminate the factors like over 2, like c. And this is also a constant, low order term, so I have big O. Fibonacci rule is this. To get that term, you add the previous two terms, okay? Fibonacci of n is defined as this. I can implement it recursively, which ends up with this recurrence equation. From a problem of size n, I create two problems, one of which is size n minus 1, and the other is size n minus 2, plus some constant work. So I will not do the substitution method here because it gets ugly. I will solve it with another trick. So I will make some observations like this cost, okay, which is the cost in question, is less than this more easy to deal with version. What is it? Tn minus 1 plus Tn minus 1 plus c. So why, first of all, why this holds? Because I have a problem. I have two problems. One is n minus 1, one is n minus 2. And here, both of them are n minus 1. So this is bigger than this. Okay. Hence, the right-hand side is bigger than the left-hand side. Okay. And luckily, I know the solution for this recurrence equation. I know that it is big O 2 to the n. So it is bounded from above by 2 to the n. If you go back to this slide, actually, we have shown you that it is equal to O 2 to the n, okay? So we know it, so we are using some previous knowledge. So I bound this weird function from above using this 2 to the n. Okay, this is my upper bound. And this is my weird function that I am dealing with, weird. I'll call it Indeed. But this is not enough. Upper bound, okay, it gives me some idea. However, this function, the constant function here, is also bounded from above by 2 to the n, right? So a lower bound will make my life better, actually. So it will be more informative. So I want to get a lower bound as well. So to get that done, this is the cost in question. It needs to be bigger than something, because I am looking for that lower bound. So I want this function to be above it. So again, let's put this function, because tn minus 2 plus tn minus 2 is less than tn minus 1 plus tn minus 2, because this guy is less than this guy. It has a smaller input. Then what is this? I haven't solved this, so let me solve this real quick. Tn is equal to 2 times tn minus 2 plus a constant. Substitution method, plug tn n minus 2 here. I end up with 2 times tn minus 4 plus c. So I end up with this part. And the stuff that I owe from above, like 2 and like c, which makes this thing. Let's do it one more step. What is tn minus 4 then? Plug n minus 4 here. I end up with 2 times tn minus 6 plus c, okay, which is here. And then I just copy paste what I owe you from above. So this is one more iteration. This is another iteration. Now I have some examples in my hand. Now I can see a pattern. So what is the behavior of the ith step, a general step? So when I drop 2i from n, when I subtract 2i, like in this case I is 3, so I is 4, in this case I is 3, I need to hit the t with 2 to the power of 3. Okay, so I have 2 to the I versus minus 2i relationship. So this is the smart part you need to see. Once you see it, everything is very easy. The same story we have been talking about. I need to obtain t0 to get rid of that t's, because t0 is equal to a number, which is 1. Problem of size 0 just has only one cost, constant cost of 1. So to get that done, I is equal to n over 2, which will give us 2 to the n over 2 times 1, and plus this term, which is the accumulation of these constants, which is what, 1 plus 3 plus 7 plus 16, so they are the sum of the powers of 2's, which I have also solved here, like with this telescopic tactic, so I know that answer as well. Okay, then, long story short, we have this function equal to 2 to the n. Again, I have shown it, so that was the lower bound, so I have another lower bound with 2 to the n. Again, their constants are different, but I don't really care, because they can be different. So this g is equal to theta of 2 to the n by the sandwich rule we have discussed. Okay, so this Fibonacci solution sucks, in other words, because it takes an exponential time to finish. It sucks because I can solve the same problem in linear time, okay, by just doing this tactic. Okay, keep a data structure like an array. First two items are initialized, then for the next item, just look to before and add them. So this is just one for loop that runs in linear time. The problem with that tactic, recursive tactic, that ended up with this time complexity, the problem is the recomputation problem. So let's see this in action. When FIP4 is executed, it calls FIP3 and FIP2 by definition. Now FIP3 calls FIP2 and FIP1, and then FIP2 calls other stuff. So FIP2 gets executed, like in this box. Then when I am done with this FIP3, I come back and I re-execute FIP2. So be careful here. It is executed from scratch, as if I haven't seen it before. But there's a problem. I have already executed FIP2, so I am recomputing it. And when you are dealing with like 40 here instead of 4, you have much more stuff in this box. Maybe you have millions of nodes here. And you recompute all of them here again. So that's why this recursive approach sucks in this case. I recommend you to go iteratively here to solve Fibonacci problem. Another recursive algorithm can be used to solve to count the positive integers in an array of size j. So I start that array by looking to the last item. So if that item, it is called with n minus 1 initially to hit the last item. If that is positive, then I count 1 and I call the new array, the existing array, but using this block because j gets shrinked 1 once to the left. And if that item is negative, it just counts nothing, but it still does that shrinking. So what happens here is, what is the cost of this function then? So given a problem of size n, okay, tn, I create one new problem of size n minus 1. So be careful here. It looks like I create two problems, but they are in the if-else block. So only one gets executed. That's why you need to be careful. You can't put two here. Then everything becomes like the Hanoi problem in the beginning. Then, so if you put that little two, then you end up with this solution, okay, which requires 2 to the n time complexity, which is terrible. However, in this array counting example, it's a simple problem. There is no 2 here. There is if else here. So we can solve this by using the substitution method. And it will just lead to n steps of action. So basically you put n minus 1 here for every, what is tn minus 1? So let me rewrite this statement. It is tn minus 2 plus c, and there is also a plus c that is waiting me from above. So as I subtract I here, I add I many c's here. Okay, that is the pattern. So to get 0 here, I set I equal to n because I have n minus I. So when I is n, I have nc, and nc makes O n complexity. So what to analyze then? So let's finish this class. We analyze worst case complexity, okay? Because it is what can happen. We need to be aware of that. Best case is not so useful because, for instance, assume your problem is searching an item in an array of n items. In the best case, that item is in the very beginning, so you hit it. And in the best case, your algorithm takes all one time, only one action. But this is very rare, very useless. You can't guarantee that that item is in the beginning. In the average case, this is again not so useful because you need to go over through all possible input scenarios to get the average. And you can't assume you have a uniform distribution, so it gets really messy. For a small problem like this, I can analyze the average complexity, but in general we avoid it. So let's go this sequential search algorithm, where I go from index 0 to n, and if I find the item, I quit and I return that index. So in the worst case, I can't find it, so I do n steps of action. In the best case, I find it in index 0, so O1. And in average case, I can find it in index 1, has one cost. For another input, I can find it at index 2, which has two cost. For another input, I can find it at index 3, etc. And in the worst case, I can find it at index n. So you can sum all of them and take the average. So this is the sum you can solve with the Gauss method. So on average case, we have O n complexity here. But again, worst case is the useful part here, which is O n for the sequential search. We can do it better if the array is sorted, like your array is, okay, so this is your array, I guess. It is sorted from 0 to 6. These are the numbers. This is not so important here. So in this array, binary search looks to the middle element. Assume that you are looking for number 4, okay? Look at the middle. Is 4 bigger than it? Yes, so then go to the right. So you skip all the problem on the left-hand side. So given a problem of size n, you create a new problem of size n over 2, okay? That is the behavior of binary search. And also you do some constant work, like comparison, etc. So 4 is bigger than 3, so I come here to this. Now this is my new problem, okay? So now I look at, this is the beginning, this is the end. 5 is the middle, 4 is smaller than this, so look at the left. So if your key is smaller, go to left. If your key is bigger, go to right. This is the whole idea, and it gets implemented easily with this iterative tactic. So let's do it real quick. Initially, this is the low, this is the high, and using these notations, middle is the middle, so left plus high over, so this is the middle m. So if the x that I look for, which is 4, if it is bigger than the middle element, then I go to right. So how can it tell it to the computer? I just move low to mid plus 1. So this is the new low. So it is not low anymore. Mid plus 1. And height, sorry, high doesn't change. So now in the next iteration, I recompute mid using these new values. So this will be your mid, number 5. And now what happens is, 4 is less than 5, so this part gets executed by shrinking high. Okay, so binary search is extremely important, you should know it by heart. And so this log complexity makes things very fast to compute, because logarithm grows very slowly. When your problem size is like 256, you need only 8 steps. But how can you see the growth here? So your problem size is 64, okay, you need 6 steps. Okay, so let's take that in our pocket. Then your problem grows suddenly 4 times, okay? But the number of steps grows only two steps. So this grows very slowly, even slower than the linear growth. Hence, logarithmic complexity is very powerful. If you can do it that way, you should do it with an algorithm that runs in logarithmic complexity. Yes, so that completes today's class. See you next week.